because of the parking lot is about 7 feet below street level, or approximately anyway, so that you're pretty much obstructing a lot of visual contact with cars without the plantings, but it's very difficult for us without any artist rendering.
Sure.
To see what that would look like.
Maureen raises the issue of bus parking in clear view of Ocean House Road. I don't have any strong feelings. Some sort of screening is probably appropriate, but I think there's not a lot of options on this side. With respect to sidewalks in general, I concur with comments on here. I think the idea of an esplanade along the new access is appropriate. I also, in general, to all these things, I can't remember what they were called, but the items that are not included in the base bid but are intended to be built, I, as a planning board member, don't care where the funding's coming from. If it's supposed to be built, I think it needs to be indicated as such on these plans, and if it's not going to be built, it needs to be indicated as such on these plans. It's all the same money one way or another, it seems. One of my biggest issues of concern right now is the Jordan Way entrance. It seems to me if you have several town personnel arguing with the appropriateness of that entrance, we need to look hard at that. I'm curious if Maureen knows if Public Works, if they object to that. They also do.
I'd just say at this point, you know, I feel strongly enough about utilizing the Jordan Way that unless I could be convinced otherwise, that I'm certainly not in favor of voting for an application or a site plan where we utilize that. I think there's another alternative of utilizing the high school entrance with two-way traffic that's far superior to utilizing Jordan Way and its impact on the town center. I think there's enough concern from public utilities and the police department that that's not a driveway to share.
Any other comments regarding that? I would just say that I am somewhat surprised to find, I'm not surprised to find a comment, but it's unusual that there are town staff involved in the building committee, and that I know that the building committee or the consultants have met with heads of department. And I guess at this point, I'm surprised to see that the department heads are still in disagreement or concerned about the alternative. And perhaps, I'm not going to read into what specifically those concerns are. One of the concerns that seems to be clearest is the fact that parents are going to be using Public Works side yard and parking areas for a drop-off out of convenience to not having to go behind the school.
Would you like me to respond to that a little bit now, or do you want to just go through everything?
I think it's best to go through everything. Again, this is not a a regular hearing. These are issues that we would like addressed, however. Please continue, Judy.
Almost all the comments on the rest of page 3 are things in general I feel that need to be addressed. I don't know that I can really add to them. And I think the comments on page 4 also I would echo. So unless we want to start delving into our own personal concerns, I'd stop right there for now.
I'd just go back to your comment about having just recently approved a site plan without a specific trees preservation plan. I think with that site plan that was appropriate, there was an area where we could simply say there's no storage of equipment or materials there. Here it's less clear. I think at least a more specific tree preservation or site preservation plan needs to be detailed. It may be part of the phasing plan, for that matter.
I just want to, any other comments? Thank you, Mr. Edsel. On page 3, there's general discussions about a more comprehensive landscaping plan. For some reason, I am sensitive to this issue, and I'm not surprised that you find yourself in this situation because it's pretty typical of many projects, let alone school projects. I would like a discussion and a presentation on the issue. The concern that I have primarily is the fact that there's a lot of additional pavement or stretching out of the circulation paths, and I think there's a need to soften the impact of that And I think there's also generally concern about the courtyard, that it's an enclosed space, it's north-facing. And I see swirling everything just north of the gym. And I think there should be special issues, special landscaping addressing either the buffering of the wind or improving of the courtyard. And if there isn't a specific budget available for landscaping today, I think with all of the color me green advertising going on in Greater Portland right now, that it would be appropriate to think about, I guess, as one of the other principals at the high school or middle school did at one time, starting an arboretum and phasing in planting, which was done in front of the high school, as I understand it, not an initial construction. But generally, the concern is that if it doesn't get placed early in the project, one never sees it, and what one sees is worn down areas with lonely pine trees. And I think it's inconsistent with the notion of what we're trying to teach within the building. So I'd look for, as the memo indicates, special attention given to that area. Yes, Judy?
I would just add, I didn't say it specifically, I think there's a lot of areas that need to be addressed. It's, you're not even clear often what the service treatment of something is on the plans. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot more attention in general all over the site is to be paid.
Okay. And yes, Steve?
Just a few more issues. Maybe, again, the items that I missed. It's a little unclear. The site plan application states that intend to use number 2 fuel oil. And then there's a question about using gas. And there's a comment about a gas line, and I think we need to deal with that. There are health and safety issues, whether it's gas, and there are health and safety issues, whether they're oil-fired furnaces. And I didn't see locations of underground storage tanks and that type of thing, or above-ground storage tanks or gas tanks, whichever it is. And maybe I just simply missed them, but those need to be detailed. I'd like to go back to the phasing plan and maybe just open it up for a little more discussion. While it's an important issue, it's sort of an intermediate part of the site plan itself, but it's where there truly are some health and safety issues involved that the planning board has jurisdiction over. I think it needs to be more clearly delineated. I can't say the word, but I know what I mean. The drop-off areas, I think it was unclear what's the rotation of portables. When are they going to be moved? And that. So just a little more detailing. Maybe we should be asking you, what do you, we're telling you more detailing in the phasing chart. Do you have questions back to us in reference to that?
Not specific questions at this point. I understand what your comments and what they mean. With the phasing, the intent of that clearly was just to kind of demonstrate that we're thinking about phasing, and we're going to be providing for the next submission a much more detailed plan that shows grading and interim pavement edges and treatments and contractor student separation issues and things like that. So that plan will be much more complete. The locations of the portables as well.
Thank you. I guess at this point I'll ask the applicant if the issues of completeness have been, if they're clear enough for you at this point, or would you like us to restate them?
Are you implying that you're finished with your discussion of those topics? The basic completeness issues I'm clear with. I do have some information tonight that we brought that responds to many of those issues that we can share with you if you'd like, or we can just wait until the next submission, but we're trying to keep up as much as we can with the pace and have that available, much of which responds to the specific first several issues of completeness that Maureen brought up in her memo.
Would the board like to hear those now?
I think the more discourse we have, the better off we are as far as timing and so forth.
Ms. Lardner?
There's no assumption that we're done discussing any issues we may have at this point, is there? For this evening.
You mean for the evening?
Yes.
In terms of completeness?
No, because we voted it was complete, but I have any number of questions that I think need to be looked at before they come back before us.
No. No, it's not closed for discussion.
Now maybe if we do go through these, it might help stimulate some discussion of more specifics, which will help us define what we provide you next time. briefly, I'll just kind of go through what you were just handed. It's a letter from me to the chair, going through those several completeness items on the memo, and then followed by several partial plans and supplemental information that is in process now, getting it more clarified on our drawings, until you get to a couple of 11 by 17s, which include the temporary classrooms for Pond Cove School. We can go through these again. I'm just showing you kind of what's in here. Temporary classrooms at the middle school side, ever so slightly more detailed phasing plan, some silt fencing information at the high school parking, and then a series of statements responding to T.Y. Lynn's memo with some supporting documentation about some of the storm-related questions. So if we want to start back on the second page of my letter on item one, again, the elevations, two elevations and a floor plan were submitted in our packet, and I have here tonight the second attachment and third attachment showing the more detail about where it's located on the face of the earth, the finished floor elevation of the storage building, and the setback information from the property lines. With regard to the issue of the easement on the adjacent property, I noticed the property owner's here tonight, and maybe he can help us out a little bit at some time, but we cannot find the easement. The surveyors have looked through the deeds, can't find anything, and we checked with the town engineer. He can't find anything in his records. Everybody seems to believe there's an easement there, but we can't find any reference to it in any of the documents. And Bob Malley believes that it possibly doesn't formally exist. While we're on that topic, however, one of the comments later on down the line from T.Y. Lynn asks, what are we going to do with that line? And the answer is, we're going to abandon it, and we're going to first define if there are any services coming into it, and then abandon it and fill it with concrete. Uh, 6A, the phasing and the portables. Again, if you look a little bit more, let's see which one is first here. We have the temporary, the first two 11 by 17s in your supplemental packet. First, the Pond Cove School side, demonstrating which, how we're laying out those four portables, and also noting that we are relocating the existing portable media center from Pond Cove School out of the way of the first phase of construction. And you can see this cluster of four classrooms and one media center, and how they're connected to the Pond Cove School access and their relationship to the fire lane and the separation between them, and just how that lays out. I've got the finished floor elevations on those so that you can see what we're thinking about in terms of how they lay out. And secondly, right behind that, we have the middle school side, same thing. In the summer of 1995, I believe, they're going to be moved from the Pond Cove side to the middle school side. And it'll be in the configuration as shown here on the second plan for that next school year. The parking issue, although we did state the numbers and we had the locations of where we had certain numbers, I have added the actual delineation of those parking spaces so that you can see what's going on. And I've also added the demonstration of the temporary drop-off for parents at the Pond Cove school site. The middle school site will use the small turnaround at the top of the sheet as you see it, and we have provided a temporary penetration through the separator between the parking and the service access so that a car can have maneuvering space to get on out after dropping off the children. And then we've also shown that we're going to use the existing turnout as it is today at Pond Cove School. So we have the two different schools accounted for in terms of drop-off. But again, the phasing plan that you'll get will show how staff and students get from those parking and drop-off areas through the construction to their respective schools. The silt fencing issue is the next plan. And we've added the silt fencing around the parking lot and around the edges of the new entrance and walk as they might be impacted over the ditch, and showing hay bales in the ditch itself. And we can get into, as we get into the T.Y. Lynn comments, we can also talk about the fact of we're using erosion control fabric to help stabilize some of the erosion in that ditch that exists today before we even introduce our stormwater, which happens to be less than is going through there today. And that brings us to 12B, which are those comments. And I'll skip those momentarily and go to demolition debris. And we recognize that we can't take most of it to the town dump or the transfer station. And we are leaving that up to the contractor, as we are with the DEP application, that although at this point we don't even know who the contractor is, so we're not quite sure where they're going to take it, but we know it's going to be a licensed facility other than Cape Elizabeth. It might well go out of state to New Hampshire.
You're talking about the asbestos removal?
No, well, that's definitely going out of state, and that's a whole separate contract, but I'm talking about just the general demolition debris.
Construction debris.
from the project itself. The only thing the town will accept is bituminous concrete and inert fill, so everything else has to go someplace else. And the tree preservation plan, I would ask, and maybe I can work this out with Maureen at a later time, but we have shown all the snow fencing locations around all the trees. In our specifications, we will also have language about no machine activity within the drip lines and so forth. I can provide that information, or if there's something else that you're looking for, I can work that out with Maureen. The remaining issues are relating to T.Y. Lynn's comments, and if you'd like us to go through those, our civil engineer, Jerry Audibert, can help you through them, or we can not get into that detail at this point.
Would you like to go through the T.Y. Lynn comments?
Some of them I would say no, like their justification for their stormwater calculations. And I'd rather the engineer look at those.
I think I'd just like to hear, in brief, the responses to that, just so we know where you're, basically what your response is to these.
And sure. Jerry, welcome through those.
Excuse me, if I do become too technical, let me know and I'll try to agree.
Just let me reiterate. This is really a coordination issue between the applicant and the town engineer. If there's any specific thing that you disagree with, I think we should know that okay. At this point. And then just a general overview of the issues.
Okay, maybe what I could do is just go through the various items and in fact, we do agree with most of the comments. They are primarily related to complete documents for construction purposes. Obviously, we're not there quite yet. The issues raised with water supply and wastewater disposal regarding fire service flow, domestic water service, and capacity to receive and treat wastewater. We have subsequently received a letter from Portland Water District. They did not address the fire flow issue, and we will request further information on that. Again, the anticipated needs of the building are essentially the same as today. We don't see that as a problem. A solid waste disposal with the dumpster that will be deleted. traffic issues, I would defer to Mr. Bray. Stormwater management issues, we have met with, as you're aware, Sebago Technics is also involved with the town center stormwater management plan. And I met with Owens McCullough Friday. And we are essentially thinking the same and pulling the last few pieces together. I don't see any concerns, nor does he, with either of our proposals or concepts. So I expect that to be clarified and completed within the next week or so. There are some calculation issues that are purely technical questions that, again, it's a matter of one engineer using one computer program versus another one using another type and infamiliarities that result and the questions that come about from that. Other issues such as profiles will be provided. We did go through and conduct initial development of these profiles at a small scale to make sure that things work, and we are currently modifying those somewhat to try to minimize ledge excavation, which we know exists on site, and coordinating that with internal plumbing, which is being is in the finalization stages. Also, I spoke with Bob Malley recently as yesterday regarding some of the remaining questions concerning the existing drainage system that the survey crew was not able to determine, and we were not fortunate enough to uncover some of the plans that evidently Bob has. So it appears now that we can complete those items, and we'll share those with Sebago Technics as well, because they also were missing some of the information. Again, it's nothing surprising. Finished floor elevations and door sill elevations will be shown. The reason they were not shown is because the project development at the time that we were completing the permit application were still being reviewed and finalized. General plan review comments, again, primarily they are construction related issues. There are a lot of clarification notes, dimensions, additional drawings, such as the plan profiles, details, things of this sort that will need to be included, and we are currently working on those and anticipate submitting those in the next package. The one item that I would like to discuss with Bob Malley somewhat is on the catch basin types. Whether they would allow the square versus round, and it's a capacity issue, purely technical. With regard to the gas line versus oil tank, I believe next week we would be hearing from the gas company, Northern Utilities, and we chose for the DEP application, which as you know is going to be a concurrent review, to show what we consider to be the worst permitting condition, which would be a buried oil tank. And the buried oil tank is shown. The piping is not, unfortunately. I didn't quite get that on. However, if the thought changes to going into the gas line, then we would show that. But again, from permitting, we felt that the oil tank would be the worst condition. If there are any questions, I'd be glad to respond.
Any questions?
I have one. Please give us some background on the issue of the natural gas line. Where would that be extended from, and at whose cost?
I'm not certain where it stops currently.
State Street.
State Street?
Yeah, it's that's exactly what we're negotiating right now, is the cost issue and the degree to which Northern Utilities would pay for it. And as I understand it, they have a tariff system requirement that they can only fund the extension if the anticipated revenues, up to 3 years of anticipated revenues. So that's what they're calculating right now. We expect to have a meeting with them or a discussion with them next week.
Would their extension, when you say State Street, you mean State Street where, in South Portland?
I don't know.
On the South Portland line?
You know, State Avenue.
Coming how to the site in?
2 miles extension.
Down Route 77.
Along 77.
What are the approval implications if that were to be the alternative selected? Is there a DEP site location permit required for bearing utilities that, over that great distance? Certainly would disturb 3 acres.
Yeah, I believe that under those conditions, that would be totally within the scope of their work. I mean, they would take care of that. They would, as their property, their service, bring that to the school, and we would just connect as a typical service connection.
Okay. Judy?
Just to follow up on that same issue, the oil tank you're talking about is the thing just labeled tank behind the 1930s building?
No, that's an existing tank to be removed. The new tank is shown on the grading and utilities plan. It's a 15,000-gallon tank right across from the, right near where the existing propane tanks are now, which will be gone. In the service area, right.
By the portables?
Right in here.
Okay.
In fact, I'm sorry, it's right in this location.
The other tank was labeled repeatedly as tank, and I didn't see it to be removed on it, so that should be labeled on there if I missed.
Yeah, we just found out that we do have to remove them. Some of them were legally filled, and some of them are about to be abandoned, and we're going to be taking all of those off.
Okay. Any other questions? Sorry, Steve, go ahead.
Sorry. Going back to a town center plan issue and parking lot, I guess without getting into discussion, I sort of rhetorically ask why would that, or is there a need for that little equipment shed to be right smack dab in the middle of the parking lot, or can it be moved to a corner? It's not in a, or let me just say, it's in an unsightly place for the equipment garage to be right in the middle. There's a wide open view corridor from Route 77. I just have these visions of a equipment shed with a couple old axles out back and a few oil pans out behind it, you know, and that's Cape Elizabeth School. I just don't think that's an appropriate place for an equipment shed, but just a comment.
Okay.
Another question on the grit and oil separator and the drainage. Is that something that requires regular maintenance where a vehicle would have to get to that?
It does require maintenance. The grit, the intent of the tank is to separate out the sands and the grit that travels with the water, stormwater, and also the oils from the parking lots. It does need to be accessed, and currently that is not shown, and I need to speak with Bob regarding how that might be done. We submitted, as you know, probably a generic maintenance plan as a first cut attempt, and we need to sit down with Bob and work that out in finer detail. Obviously, that tank is one of those details. Mm.
Okay.
Thank you. I see that your traffic engineer is still with us. Is Bill still here?
Yes.
Yeah, there he is hiding behind. Bill, Maureen's has a question, and I guess, first of all, what we'd like to do is to have you please get up to the podium, introduce yourself.
It was very comfortable back there. Good evening. My name is Bill Bray, and I've performed a traffic study for the project. Actually, I prepared the one for the public works facility prior to this. I guess it'd be probably much easier if I just responded to any questions that board members might have.
One of the issues that, let me just get this out of the way, is the impact of taking the buses up the high school drive. We'd like your response to that. The additional 26, Maureen feels that the additional 26 trips will decrease the level of service left turn from a margin of C to D.
Okay, first of all, let me turn to it specifically here. My My table one that I've provided the board indicates that it would be level of service C at that location, with the left turn exiting the facility.
Just to reference what page, is there a page?
It's just table one, intersection, highway capacity summary.
Yep.
That would be at level of service C. Again, all of those buses do not necessarily go out during the peak hour either. That's something that happens over a two-hour period.
There were some questions by department heads about why Jordan Way was still being used, and I guess my question, I had a sense that there was a discussion at one point about having all the buses go up the high school driveway and exit out the high school driveway instead of using Jordan Way. And the question was, if you were to add those additional trips, I think 26 buses was the number I heard, is one of the reasons that you don't want to use the high school driveway as an entrance as well as an exit, is that it's going to drop the level of service of that intersection?
Well, if it's going to affect anything, it will affect the entering traffic, not the exiting traffic. Jordan Way was obviously intended to be used only as the entrance for the buses, with the exiting all occurring at the high school driveway. Without going through the actual calculation of the numbers, I can't stand here and say absolutely that it wouldn't maybe drop below C to D. Quite frankly, even then, I wouldn't be overly alarmed. It's just going to be a little added delay for someone making that left turn. But any time that you can split the impact of a project of any magnitude between two entrances and lessen the impact at one, then I think there is clearly a traffic advantage to doing that. So that's why clearly I'm supportive of splitting the entrance of the buses from the added confusion of all the motor vehicle traffic entering through the high school entrance and also exiting at that point. I think there's clearly an advantage to separating that bus traffic from the motor vehicle traffic.
Mr. Emery?
Yes.
Mr. Bray, if it goes that the preference is to have bus access through the high school, given that the high school students will already be, I believe, in school when maybe the first middle school buses go in, or I might have the order wrong, and certainly all the parking will be done before the elementary school buses start rolling in, is there a real reason why you would argue against using that other than what you just said?
I guess I would actually want to go back and look at that a little more closely, only because there is basically a continuous flow of buses in and out of the facility for about an hour and a half. And I would like to see that, how it compares to the peak arrival times of the high school traffic and what happens during that period, because I know some of the high school buses, as they drop off their students, they actually depart the site to go pick up the elementary school children. So there may be some conflicts that possibly would occur, and I'd like to be a little more sure of that before I answered you.
Okay.
Any other questions?
I'd just like Mr. make sure, Mr. Bray, if you could look into that. I mean, I said before that I'm certainly not in favor of utilizing Jordan Way. In the past, the issue has been a matter of timing. We were told that the buses don't arrive and depart at the same time. There does seem to be continuous flow of buses, but it'll be much different flow because there will be, my understanding, no buses from the Scott Dyer side at all.
That's correct.
To get some type of concept of what impact that will have. Interesting to see what you come out. I happen to be an expert traffic surveyor myself, since I spend a lot of time dropping off kids. So if you need any information, I can tell you how many seconds I wait to get out.
Well, we've actually got the times recorded of when they enter and exit the facility. So we can go back and look at that pretty carefully.
Any other questions or comments?
Yes, go ahead. On the same issue?
Yes.
Okay, no.
I would only add that, it's a traffic issue. I don't see specific discussion of the overall site circulation within your report. It seems more of a traffic impact statement.
And the layout of the parking lots, again, I don't want to get into substantive review, but the layout of the parking lots, particularly off that loop road, seemed somewhat, well, there are two issues. One, the number of driveways for the number of cars proposed, and then the different configurations of dead-end parking lots. I think it would be helpful if you would comment on the general circulation patterns. One thing that hasn't been discussed in terms of the issue of access of the buses to and from, or all of the buses arriving from the high school entrance and returning to the high school entrance, is the issue of the width of the connection between the middle school, elementary school drop-off area and that, what is now a one-way road south. Has that been discussed? Did that enter at all into the decision to use Jordan Way as the entrance?
It really didn't alarm me whether it was something that Dennis considered when they originally had proposed it that way. I'm not sure, but the width of that, because quite frankly, the majority of it will be a one-way road anyway, so there is ample room for a bus to pass there. You know, the roadway is clearly wide enough to handle that.
For two-way traffic?
Yeah, it's a little tight, but it's obviously not something you're going to have a number of vehicles passing side by side there.
Any other questions for Bill? Thank you. Judy, I have a sense that you have quite a number of issues there that you'd like to raise.
I do, and it'd be okay for me just to skim them. And
yeah, I think that's a mess.
First has to do with the wetland areas identified in the Woodlot Alternatives Plan. I see in this new submission we received this evening, it shows a wetland that's near the relocated basketball court. It looks substantially smaller than the one identified in the Woodlot Alternatives Plan. I think the proper, whatever they are, wetland boundaries need to be put on one of the large site plans, because from that original report, it looked questionable. I would like to hear the final DEP, if they were going to make the determination of the so-called drainage ditch, whether that was a regulable wetland or not. And the report also mentions that the Army Corps would be involved in some of those wetlands, so whatever permits are appropriate, I'd like to hear about another evening. Want to make sure that no wetland special permits are required for anything, including the basketball court, the handicap ramp, if that remains shown on the plan, and the access to the proposed parking lot. Question whether street trees and an esplanade will be required along Scott Dyer as required under our zoning ordinance, has to be looked into. Blasting in particular concerns me. There's a statement in there when talking about blasting that we basically have to expect aesthetic or minor aesthetic damage of the buildings, and given that things are falling on children and teachers now without blasting, I think I'd like to see a very detailed blasting schedule, and I'm hoping that will be done when students are not there. I'd like to see clarification on the type and location of all signs on the property, clarification on the circulation pattern of the kindergarten buses. I'm guessing they're going through that parking lot when they exit that loading area. And I think the aesthetics of the high school entrance need to be considered. The thought of this steel guardrail just covering the high school entrance is kind of disturbing to me. I don't know if bollards and chains could be used instead, but something should be considered there. I'd like an explanation again at a later date of this future parking lot and how that ties in with the plans we're looking at now. I think all references on the plan that talk about or say by others need to be clarified. If it's part of the project we're approving, those references need to be eliminated, I believe. Let's see if I can find new ones. Again, clarification on who is responsible for the sidewalk and the parking lots at the high school. I think in general, as I mentioned before, the landscaping plan has to have a lot more detail of the surfaces of a lot of areas, the planting islands, the courtyards, the fire lanes. I'm assuming some of that will be the, I can't remember what it's called, but the equivalent of grasscrete. And I also would like to hear more explanation of the purpose of that large courtyard that is at the north, yes, there with the timber wall. I'm absolutely confused what's going on there. Some discrepancies on the plan. On sheet L101 and 102, the length of the fire lane east of the middle school is different, substantially different. There's also a fence detail that is addressing the fence along the new, or the proposed access road. I think there's a discrepancy between the 1x6. I think one says cedar and the other says pressure-treated pine. I'd like some indication of the building materials on the plans, just so we know. They're so small, it's not clear to me how much is brick and how much is other surfaces. I echo the concern about increasing landscaping along the access drive between the Farm Hill houses. And I think last and possibly least, as I do think there needs to be a middle school sign above the entrance that again is on the east side of the building in that large courtyard area. I think that's it.
Thank you, Judy. Any other questions or comments for the applicant? Mr. Edsel.
Just a few last things, and some of them duplicate the Judy's comments, and I have the same confusion about the courtyards because I'm not seeing any rendering or elevations in there. And I think, rightfully so, there are some health and safety issues. I would look at the least expensive way to present that to us. You know, how can you give us a rendering of what the elevation of those courtyards will be? There are safety issues involved with all of those. Again, a difficult one, difficult item when a town appointed board reviews a town school department on a town owned property. Where do we stop? But I'm perhaps overly concerned about the asbestos disposition, and it's easy to say that we'll leave it up to the contractor. I think in the best interest of the town, for health and safety reason, I've been involved with that with myself in my own professional life, and the town of Cape Elizabeth's name doesn't go off from that asbestos. Wherever it goes, it stays with it. And so I think at least some more detailing on what the proposed I understand that some of that is detailed by federal law, AHERA, whatever the acronym is for the disposal of school related asbestos. I appreciate the applicant coming up with a reasonably good design for the pullout for the buses at the high school. One thing that I didn't notice was the resulting slope of that entrance and how that might affect handicapped access. I don't know whether that exceeds whatever the 5%, 2.5%, I can't remember what it is. When you cut into that slope, you're going to increase the slope. You cut into the ground there, you're going to increase that slope of that. I'm sure there's a resolution to that, but it would be a concern. And the last one is a duplicative of Judy's, and that is the other surfaces on the structures themselves. What will those presumably blank looking areas, what is that material, I guess? And that's it.
Any other comments? I'll add one more item, and this comes under, I guess, the town center / school site plan, is the issue of access through the site for pedestrians. It's not unusual. There's a lot, as you know, there's a lot of residential areas to the north of the site. And the issue is that people walk from those residential areas up to the track, walk around the track, and then walk back either down Scott Dyer Road or some people in the Brentwood neighborhoods and other locations. It's quite clear if you're coming from the west on Scott Dyer Road that you would just simply enter the site and head along that, whatever configuration you want to take along the access drive. What if you come up Hill Way as a pedestrian? I guess for either access to the rest of the school site or for as a visitor to the building. It's not unreasonable that parents who live in that area could be walking to the building. It would be perhaps unusual, but not unreasonable. just give me a brief description. That's where I get hung up with this plan, is I sort of feel like I have to walk around the building to get to the front, and that's a very uncomfortable feeling.
The access from Hill Way or anywhere on this side of the site will come along this existing walk, and there'll be a striped crosswalk right at this location connecting to the new sidewalk that we are providing and bringing that right into the courtyard. And from this location, children can walk either into the school, the elementary school, into the middle school, or again through another crosswalk and then down this fire lane slash access to the playground area for their play. Getting around from, to get around to this side for the middle school, they would have to go right around this way as well.
And you, one would be able to get by the east side of the elementary school and onto the access road or sidewalks to the high school. That won't be fenced.
From here?
Well, if you come from Hill Way and head east on Scott Dyer, come down past the school. This is someone walking on a weekend.
All the way down here.
Is one able to get through that? Is there?
Yes, there's a new gate being proposed there. There's a fence there now. We're going to take that out to the extent we need to and put in a gate so that there's easy access through. Because that's where the kids are going to come through in the morning as well, through that gate into that space.
And that gate will be accessible during weekend hours as well?
I don't see why not. The entire space is accessible, so there'd be no reason to cut that off.
Okay. Well, I think we've, any other discussion? I think we've given you quite a full palette. Your general review comments were that it was complete, and it's very tricky, as you know, when we're dealing with completion issues, not to get into the detail and substantive issues of the plan.
Yes, that's very true, but I do have a question in that regard. And that relates to T.Y. Lynn's comments, and maybe again this on a staff level we can resolve this, but many of the comments to me appear to be more contract document related requests, and many of the comments are clearly required clarifications and information they need to make their judgment as to whether or not the project works. I'd like to be able to understand that distinction, so for our next meeting we bring only the things that we need for that purpose, and we can provide the contract document set near the end of the process so they can have us as their final package all of those other contract related issues like location of things, very specific, how do you know that the catch basins are going to be here when you haven't built the parking lot yet kind of issues. And maybe again we can work that out on a staff level, but that's a question that I would have for the board.
That's sort of a two-pronged issue in that if the board to get substantive review of the project, unfortunately, whether it's this project or any other project, you're essentially, I'll use the technical term, well into design development on a project. The phrase was used the other day, the boat has already sailed in terms of many of the issues, which we have obviously delegated to the building committee. But there are issues that I still see in terms of landscaping and some of the other issues that will come out of an initial substantive review of the plan.
I'm pretty clear on most of those things that we need to have those next time around. It was just some of the things that your engineer brought up that seemed like that can wait until that next phase, but we'll work that out. I know you can't sit here and tell me which ones are and aren't required, but that's just an issue I want to raise.
Judy?
Just going to say, Mr. Judd, often we can have quite a few comments from our town engineer, and sometimes he says, you know, these can be addressed as a condition of approval, and often he'll say these must be addressed before we should give final approval, and I think you could get that information from him, what he feels comfortable with. I didn't mention this, but I did echo, and I don't think this is a construction document concern, his request for all the elevations of the catch basin rims and all the elevations of the door sills. I think this is a really tricky site with respect to drainage, and I'm very skeptical. I mean, just witness what's gone on so far and over by the high school. There's a lot of water that flows to those buildings.
And there's no problem with that. This information will be on the plans, and given our schedule, they're kind of coming together anyway. So as we wrap up this process, we're going to be wrapping up our contract document process, and there'll be one at that point. I'm concerned with the public hearing issue and getting that submission and addressing all of the required issues for that meeting. That's my biggest concern at this point. And we can go through that with Maureen and with T.Y. Lynn and just go down the list and define which ones he really needs.
While you're on the subject, would you describe briefly with us the issue of your schedule in terms of where you fit in with the DEP process and bidding?
Yes. The DEP process, we're resolving a couple of technical issues with the storm design, and that will go out this week. And tracking that, we hope for about a two-month timeline. We hope that we're through this process by May, possibly into June if we need to be, but construction is anticipated to start July 1st, or the early July, and we're all moving. I know it's aggressive. We've been working on this a while as well, but it's very important, it's extremely important that we start this summer, otherwise we'll be pushed back a full year. So that's our goal, to work toward that. We want to do everything we can to give you the information you need, and we would appreciate clarity on what we need to give you so that we can all work together on that.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me, one second.
Yes, Mr. Stevens.
Paul Stevens, just wanted to address one detail of schedule just so that you won't be surprised. As part of the bidding process on this project, we are doing a pre-qualification process for contractors, which takes a fair amount of time to do properly. And given the fact that, as Dennis mentioned, we want to start construction early in July, that means that we'll be receiving bids potentially in late June. In order to do that, I don't want you to be surprised, but the first ad for the pre-qualification submission packets from contractors will be in the paper on March 26th. So I don't want you to think that we're jumping the gun, but we need to start that process kind of concurrent with this planning board process to be sure that we have all that in order. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. One outstanding issue is the issue I need a motion regarding the public hearing. Judy?
Henry, I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the school department for site plan review of renovations and construction located at the middle and elementary schools be tabled to the April 25th, 1994 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you very much. I think that's the last item on the agenda. And before we recess, this is nothing big. This is
embarrassing.
No, I'm not going to. I'm embarrassed myself more than you. You're not going anywhere yet. We've developed, again, I did this out of proxy. The board is a little bit surprised. First of all, as a planning board, I think what we're doing is we'd like to commend Steve for his 2 years almost of chairmanship and many other years of service. And at the same time in doing so, we'd like to acknowledge being green by having incredibly well-simulated wood frames on these plaques that I know you'll proudly hang on your walls. But first of all, what we'd like to present you with is your Cape Elizabeth Town Center design guidelines. Has all the details you'd ever need to know on fenestration and other matters, including an HHE 200 form printout. And then
thank you. See, Trade Center, I like that one.
Award number one, which was suggested by the Wetlands Subcommittee of the Planning Board, reads, to Steve Etzel, voted Mr. HHE 200 1993-94 by the American Society of Planning Board Soil Specialists. Congratulations on that award.
Thank you.
And most importantly, and this is certainly one I won't be able to follow, and this was done with some cahoots here, someone sitting directly to my right, to Steve Etzel, best dressed planning board chairman to ever serve more than one consecutive term, March 1994. Thank you very much, Steve.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed it. Thank you.
With that, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Meeting's adjourned. Thank you.
Radio 1 brings you Radio Deutsche Welle, the German Foreign Broadcasting Service. For the next 50 minutes, you'll hear the latest news and business information coming from Germany, as well as features on German...